human heart yearns for the infinite riches which lie beyond, knowing that there is to be found the satisfying answer to every question as yet unanswered. And faith liberates reason insofar as it allows reason to attain correctly what it seeks to know and to place it within the ultimate order of things in which everything acquires true meaning. What all this means is that in our common, insatiable search for meaning, purpose, truth, faith is not optional. We just have to look at history to see how much, when left to reason alone, we're stuck with a terrible impasse. One leading to mystic scholar, Dominican Father James Brent, comments on this predicament. He says, human reason has many questions, but the history of thought proves that human reason faces great difficulties in finding shared answers to its own most profound questions. Philosophical questions about whether life has a meaning and what it is, whether there is a God, why God would permit evil, whether human beings have a purpose and happiness beyond life in this world and what it is, whether it is possible for universal justice ever to be secured in human society, and other such fundamental questions have been raised in all or most societies. But answers to those questions seem also to elude human reasoning, both with philosophers and with common people. Faith in divine revelation, however, speaks to all of these questions and more. When one believes by faith the testimony offered by God, one receives answers to the questions of life, and those answers are susceptible to support, defense, and illumination by reason. Or in the words of the author considered to be the definitive biographer Thomas Aquinas, Dominican Father Jean-Pierre Torel, only faith allows us to encounter the reality beyond the formulas that attempt to express it. Or as St. Thomas himself tells us, in the progress of knowledge, the human mind is usually most helped if its natural intelligence is strengthened by a new light, the light of faith. By that light, the mind recognizes that God lies above and beyond everything that it can know by nature. Thomas Aquinas didn't devote his life to research, writing, teaching, and scholarship because he was an erudite and studious sort of guy. He did it as his way of getting as close as he possibly could to God. Yes, but, you might reply, he was a mega-intelligent brainiac. And if you were to say that to St. Thomas, he would take that word, intelligent, as he often did, and turn to the etymology of the Latin intelligere, and calling upon his theory of interpretation, he would tell you that that word is made up of two words, intus and legere, which put together mean to read within, to penetrate beneath the sensible surface and discern the rational meaning. This is a penetration into the very essence or substance of a thing. That's the true value of intelligence for St. Thomas Aquinas. An intelligent person is one who wants to read within things, to penetrate to the deepest meanings, to get to what is real. Ironically, one thing that human reason all on its own is very good at is bringing us to the certainty of the reality of God. In the Summa, St. Thomas observed, in all of us there has been implanted by nature something that leads to a knowledge of the existence of God. Very likely, it was this conviction that attracted the American author Flannery O'Connor to the writings of St. Thomas Aquinas. In her letters, she admits, I read the Summa for about 20 minutes every night before I go to bed. If my mother were to come come in during this process and say, turn off that light, it's late. I, with lifted finger and broad, bland, beatific expression, would reply in the form of a Summa article, on the contrary, I answer that the light, being eternal and limitless, cannot be turned off. Shut your eyes, or some such thing. And Flannery O'Connor probably ascribed to the counsel that Thomas Aquinas borrowed from St. Jerome. Never let a book be absent from your eyes and hand. No wonder then that Thomas Aquinas was always absorbed and preoccupied in adapting his thought to the matters and concerns of the world, which he considered to be the philosopher's chief purpose in life. In the assessment of Dominican Father A.G. Sertillange, Thomas tackled these problems not out of curiosity or ambition, but because they were of importance to humankind. He thought in order to live himself and to help others to live. He sought to find his way about the world that he might walk in it and help us to walk. St. Thomas agreed with Plato. Error about things that it is our duty to study is as bad as murder. St. Thomas Aquinas referred to the whole of his work as sacra doctrina, but that expression means much more than the English suggests, sacred doctrine. Sacra doctrina is a significantly broader reality than theology alone. It incorporates all forms of Christian teaching at all levels. As the famous editor of the 60-volume English Summa, Dominican Father Thomas Gilby, points out, sacra doctrina is an imparting of God's mystery to human beings, which is a communicating of his life, not merely the conveying of information. The effect of sacra doctrina is an invigoration of the mind's own proper vitality, contemplative and active, shaping human activity in the bustle of temporal affairs. According to the testimony of those who lived with him, Thomas Aquinas on occasion would place his head tenderly against the tabernacle in the hopes of discovering its secret, like a little child. St. Thomas was thoroughly convinced that a person enlightened by the gift of wisdom possesses an intimate familiarity with divine things that the theologian cannot procure merely by his pure science. So in a sermon that he preached at the University of Naples, the great common doctor of the church was heard to say to his devout hearers, any elderly woman today knows more about divine things than did all the philosophers of antiquity put together. And as a witness at St. Thomas' canonization proceedings attested, when Friar Thomas preached at Naples, he was interrupted by the tears of his congregation. They were crying because St. Thomas made them happy, for happiness, as he taught, is the joy produced by truth. What all this is showing us is that we don't engage in the pursuit of wisdom just to become cerebral or smart. The angelic doctor assures us the learned person not only attains to knowledge of divine things, he also experiences them. Literally, he suffers them. That is, not only does he receive them as knowledge into his mind, he also becomes one thing with them by love and by affection. There's something momentous held out to us through the eminent and ardent pursuit of wisdom. St. Thomas tells us what that is. The pursuit of wisdom is more noble than other human pursuits because, through this pursuit, the human being approaches to a likeness to God who made all things in wisdom. And since likeness is the cause of love, the pursuit of wisdom especially joins the human being to God in friendship. intent of this is to be discovered in the very word we have designated to refer to an institution of higher learning. We call this place where we earn academic degrees a university. And the word university is a shortened version of the Latin universitas magistrorum escolarium, which can be translated as community of teachers and scholars. Before all else, a university is a community. It is not a coincidence that Dante referred to St. Thomas Aquinas as an intellectual light full of love. The Doctor of Humanity wants to model for us in every way how to live in a lasting union with God, to live the charity that is friendship. He goes so far as to claim that the human being approaches nearer to God through love than through reason, because in love the human being does not act himself, but in a manner of speaking, drawn nearer by God himself. According to St. Thomas, what is the primary purpose of human law? His answer, to cause friendship between people. And what is the primary purpose of divine law? To establish friendship between human beings and God. So too, a singular purpose of the Catholic University is to provide a sacred locus where that communion of divine charity can flourish, a place where we can draw near to God through love. Friendship is critical if we are ever to be victorious in the struggle between the goading of human desire and our search for spiritual wisdom. For as the Angelic Aquinas teaches us, the happy person needs friends in this life. Friends enable us to be our truest self. Without friends, one would be likely to lose enthusiasm for and interest in the activity of virtuous living. Friends act virtuously towards each other, mutually feeding the motivation of the other to act in a virtuous way. By looking at our friends, we can look at ourselves in a less biased fashion. For example, when St. Thomas Aquinas considers something like disordered sexual lust, what he finds so evil in it is how it is utterly opposed to the very possibility of friendship. So he singles out 8 effects of sinful lust. Look at what these are: blindness of mind, thoughtlessness, inconstancy, rashness or impertinence or temerity, self-love, hatred of God, love of the present world, and despair regarding the future world. The lustful person is not unhappy just because of the bad sex they engage in. The lustful person is unhappy because they are incapable of having or being a friend. Friendship, our spiritual master insists, begins only with reciprocity, redamatio, to love in return, which means that the key to the pursuit of wisdom, whose goal is to be joined in friendship with God, is prayer. Prayer is the judgment, in the judgment of St. Thomas, is the indispensable interpreter of desire. It's what we're meant to do with our desire so that desire doesn't torment us. This is why the wisest Catholic University student does not distinguish too much between oratory and laboratory. St. Thomas promises you, if a person submits their learning and their other powers to God, his devotion as a direct result will be deepened. This is done, St. Thomas advises us in his commentaries on the Psalms, simply by raising, elevating the soul to God. The elevation of faith through the admiration of God's grandeur the elevation of hope by straining toward beatitude, the elevation of charity through intimate union with God and His holiness, the elevation of justice by imitating God's justice in our own actions towards Him and towards others. Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger reflects on the priority of praise in the spirituality of Thomas Aquinas. He writes, St. Thomas says that through the praise of God, the human being ascends to God. Praise itself is a movement, a path. It is more than understanding, knowing, and doing. It is an ascent, a way of reaching Him who dwells amid the praises of the angels. Thomas mentioned another factor. This ascent draws the human being away from what is opposed to God. It awakens the inner man. Reason gets us close to God. Love expressed through prayer gets us nearer. And the nearer a being stands to God, says St. Thomas, the further away it is from nothingness. And who doesn't want to be far away from nothingness? So, we study and we pray because we want to live life boldly. And the boldest people, the dumb ox bellows, are those who are rightly related to divine things. All those who think rightly recognize that the end of human life is found in the contemplation of God. As he lay dying in the Cistercian Abbey of Fossanova, Thomas Aquinas, contemplating God, dictated to the monks there a commentary on the Song of Songs. His dying words were a love letter to his divine friend. Thomas Aquinas was about 49 years old when he died, and remarking on the tragedy of Thomas dying so young, one biographer says that thought like a raging fire had used up his strength. St. Thomas may be who the 14th century Rhineland Dominican mystic Johannes Tauler had in mind when he wrote, "A man may die of a broken heart, because God works in him so vehemently that it is more than he can bear." The published acts of the canonization process of Thomas Aquinas relate that after Thomas's death, his beloved teacher and master who survived him, St. Albert the Great, could not bear to hear the name of Thomas spoken without bursting into tears. Leonard Cohen, in that song, "Come Healing," makes this plea. O solitude of longing where love has been confined, come healing of the body, come healing of the mind. O see the darkness yielding that tore the light apart, come healing of the reason, come healing of the heart. Let the heavens falter, let the earth proclaim, come healing of the altar, come healing of the name. And another hymn writer, a glorious inductee of the Angelic Hall of Fame, replies, "Being born, he became our friend. At supper, he became our food. Dying, he was our ransom's price. And reigning is our eternal good. O sacrifice for our salvation, heavenly gates you opened wide. Our enemies pressed hard around us, give us strength, our help provide. To the one in triune God, be glory and eternal praise. May he grant us life forever, and to our home, our souls upraise. Amen." Thank you.